have power. They can destroy and create. We can choose to use this force constructively with words of encouragement or destructively use words of despair.
Words have energy and power with the ability to help, to heal, to hinder, to hurt, to harm, to humiliate, and to humble. Here at Pathways World School Aravali, we feel it is vital to put our words to a greater use and make an impact in society. Inspireability offers a platform for students to share their thoughts and opinions on several topics concerning the world.
Students get a chance to talk about unique topics through this conference to reach a larger audience. Today, our students will enlighten you about topics that are close to their hearts by relating them to the theme of the perpetual shift. Before we start the event, we would like to call upon Ms. Sonia Gandhi Mehta, the school director, to say a few words.
Ralph Waldo very rightly said, "Don't go where the path may lead. Go instead where there is no path and leave a trail," unquote. A very good evening to my dear students, our guest speakers, and parents. Most of us, including the surviving generations above us, have had a first-hand experience of the challenging times like this COVID-19 pandemic in their lifespan. We have often heard and read quotes like, "Change is the only constant," and "Tough times don't last, tough people do." And this is exactly what has been proven today, that resilience is the only attribute we must concentrate on. This year's thought-provoking themes of perpetual shift and never-ending construction at hashtag Inspireability have been decided, keeping in sync with the trying times that we are all passing through today. I am sure each one of our speakers will help us put a perspective to life and how to tackle situations that life throws at us as surprises. I don't want to detract from the main stars today and would like to end by quoting Farah Gray. "Build your own dreams or someone else will hire you to build theirs," unquote. Stay well, stay safe, and God bless.
Thank you, ma'am. Your words never fail to inspire us.
We now would also like to call upon the middle school principal, Ms. Monica Bajaj, to speak a little about the event.
A very warm welcome to hashtag Inspireability. I'm extremely delighted that the legacy of middle school wise talks, now hashtag Inspireability, goes on. The journey that began last year is now an annual event. I congratulate the students of MYP5, backed by the students of MYP4, for executing this two-day event, not just in terms of logistics and organization, but also training the speakers. Their experience has truly been a unique one, and they have been able to exercise the student agency really beautifully. I'm thankful to Mr. Harinder S. Sikka and Mr. Vikramjeet S. Rubrai for sparing their time and sharing their experiences and opinions with our audience. Thanks to the management and Ms. Mehta for having faith in middle school team and their continued support. I'm glad that this event gives the platform to as many as 20 students in middle school, including the students right from MYP1. I hope you gain new insights from the conversations around never-ending construction and perpetual shift, and truly enjoy hashtag Inspireability. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for your encouraging words and support. Now we would like to call upon the student who was the very first organizer, the pioneer of this event. We would like to call upon Maurya Sharma from DP1.
Thank you, Kripa, and Vatsal and this Middle School Student Council for inviting me to talk about this event. This event has been in the making since I was in the Student Council. Gia and I, we led this event forward with under the guidance of Ms. Abhilasha and Ms. Monica. And ever since, it was all of our ambitions that it turns out to be a success. I'm really excited to see how the entire event pans out. I feel that some of our speakers have chosen fabulous topics and have undergone great, tremendous training. And I hope them best of luck, and I really look forward to seeing this new event and how it manifolds.
Thank you so much, Maurya. With your imagination, today we have been able to take Inspireability forward with us. And now we have this year's heads of conference and also our very own middle school student council presidents, Kripa Talwar and Vatsal Kabra.
Welcome, esteemed guests, to Inspireability. It is an honor to have you here. As Maurya rightly said, the event has been in the making since 2019, and I vividly remember having auditioned for it, unsure if I would even be a part of it. Fast forward to 2021. Being on the other side of the event, I have learned a lot. All of Maurya's emails finally make sense to me, as I was the one writing them this time around. The makings of this event have been a tiring job, but at the same time, memorable. We would like to thank the entire organizing committee who worked day and night to make Inspireability possible. And I hope you all get inspired by our budding speakers.
As we started the organization process and reviewed the participants' ideas, their level of thought, analysis, and depth genuinely staggered me. Based on the circumstances presented to us, I'm very proud of the effort and outcome, both behind the scenes and the one that will be shown to you. We would additionally like to thank Ms. Abhilasha Yadav, Ms. Monica Bajaj, and Ms. Sonia Gandhi Mehta for their constant support and feedback, which has proven invaluable. We hope you enjoy and learn from this event as much as we have. Without further ado, I would like to hand it over to the MCs to carry on the proceedings.
Thank you so much, Kripa and Vatsal. This event would have never been possible without your relentless efforts. And I think especially after your speech, we all can't wait to hear our participating speakers today. Now we would like to call upon our esteemed guest speaker for today, Mr. Harinder Sikka. Mr. Sikka is the Group Director at Strategic Businesses Piranamal Group and has been with the group for over 2 decades. He's a prolific writer and has contributed scores of articles in leading English dailies. He's also authored 2 books titled Calling Sehmat and Vichoda. Sir, we're truly honored to have you with us today.
Hi, I'm Harinder Sikka. I work for the Piranamal Group. And I'm here to talk to you about construction, a subject that your wonderful school has chosen. As we know, life is the only constant. It is but always the most needed and shall take place whether we like it or not. What is not moving shall decay, be it water, air, materials, or even human body. Whatever is not moving, whatever is not figuring out with the atmosphere of or climate, it will decay. This is the law of nature. We can do nothing about it. And it applies to all without exception. Come to think of it, the Lord Almighty also is engaged in construction and both destruction all the time. Billions of stars, planets are broken on day-to-day basis, minute-to-minute basis, and reconstructed, you know. And humans do the same. They simply follow what the God Almighty does. We construct, go on constructing, and then break. Whether we break or the nature does the needful for us. But this change continues all the time. The technology barriers, as we see, the world has grown in the past 10 years more than it did in the past maybe 100 years more. Communication has changed today. Your science has changed today. The medicine has changed today. So how do you cope up? How do you cope up with the new challenges? That's the question that children face today. Well, in my personal opinion, COVID has given us a a new kind of position to brainstorm upon. You know, times are coming very rapidly that we need to be all the time thinking out of box. So how do you do it? You know, with so much negativity floating around us, with television channels degrading the other, with every human being trying to look better than the other, in one form or the other, competition is growing out of seams. So what do? That is where you need to balance yourself. And in the times to come, it is even more important that you balance yourself. First thing first is that you have to grow out of discrimination business. People say, oh, Flana so-and-so is scheduled caste, scheduled tribe, Brahmin, Rajput. These are figments of our imaginations. You know, your strength is that you are the best. Your strength is that the Creator created you. The Shastras talk about Kai Janam Bhayo Keet Patanga. They were not wrong. We come from what age, in what cycle. So if you understand yourself, you are the best, then you have all the opportunity to prove yourself that you are the best. And you have to learn to fight it all. Because the simple reason is, all prayers are answered. Now I'll share with you something that happened to me much later in life. You guys are younger and no need to really worry about in that quick fashion, but I had to. I didn't have good meals or sufficient meals at home in quantities, and I don't think I ever went with my parents out to have a meal in a restaurant. It was unthinkable at one point of time. And there were so many constraints upon us. But there was this urge to do something out of the world, out of the book. Do something very classic. So I used to listen to Ramayana, Granth Sahib, everything. Then I learned what a squirrel did during the building construction of the bridge, Ram Setu. Even the squirrel carried a grain. Everything mattered at that time. Everything matters at all the times. So I started writing a book. My first book, Calling Samar, I wrote as if I was the best. I had faith in myself and I did not know how to write. But there's so much of work, so much of strength, so much of willpower, so much of self-motivation. It took me first book 8 years to write. But then it broke all records. It got printed into 6 languages. It went to Tel Aviv. It made into a film, Razi. I also made a film thereafter, Nanak Shah Fakir. And I said, I'm the best. I have faith that my prayers will be answered. And they were. The very first film won 3 national awards. Here, on top of me, something is hanging over my head, telling me that yes, it was achievable. Imagine the first book you write, it becomes the best. The first film you produce becomes the best. Then came Vichoda. Vichoda gave me a lot of lessons in life. That was a story of a woman who had faith, immeasurable faith, of how she searched out her children she had lost 6 decades ago. So while we construct ourselves, our minds, our bodies, our lives, we must understand that we will have ultimate trust and faith only if we believe in that one Creator, not necessarily what lies in temples and gurdwaras and what have you. Because if your watch has a maker, your body also has a maker. So have a little communication with that figure which is unseen, unborn, but exists, and tell yourself you're the best. You'll be able to construct what most have not been able to. Thank you. Jai Hind.
sir, for your time. We truly learned a lot from you today.
Now, for the moment all of you have been waiting for, we present to you Inspireability. And our very first speaker for this conference is Vatsal Kabra. Vatsal will explore how recent changes in society and individual behavior have led to mass assimilation and complacency among all age groups of the population.
Everything can be taken from a man, but one thing, the last of the human freedoms, to choose one's attitude in any given set of circumstances, to choose one's own way. Society is a word that means many different things to different people. For some, it is a stage of interaction. For others, it is the group that marginalized them. For others still, it is a comfort zone. But for people, and those crucially like me, feel that society has changed in a manner so adverse, it has largely become an innovation stifling, growth stunting, and community assimilating machine. Now don't get me wrong, I love people, individuals, but I don't find it fun when they give up their virtues and pursuits for a social standing or some other superficial gain whose only basis lies in our perception. Throughout history, philosophers have quoted about excellence, greatness, and personal growth, a field predominantly reserved for philosophers since everybody else was busy toiling in, well, a field. As society progressed and people could be bigger than their physical capabilities, famous personalities made similar remarks. Here are two that form the basis of my speech by demonstrating a near primal quest for greatness as part of the human experience. Ancient Chinese philosopher Confucius said, "The will to win, the desire to succeed, the urge to reach a full potential, these are the keys that will unlock the door to personal excellence." And marketing genius Steve Jobs quoted, "We don't get a chance to do that many things, and everyone should be really excellent because this is our life." These two, along with most other sayings, talk about the fact that some form of achievement is the way to profitability and enjoyment, in addition to having larger and longer lasting effects like self-confidence and self-esteem, traits that we lack pretty much generationally. Why do we lack them though? Thinking about it, the elements we most engage with in terms of time and intensity would be family, friends, school, and now the internet. There is a shift in the way they function that must have led to a certain degree of self-deprecation. It is important to note that the changes I talk about are only in the context of my talk and don't represent these systemic changes as a whole. Some of these shifts are an obsession with the superficial. This phenomenon is demonstrated by the fact that DMs form the basis of a friendship and the lives of celebrities are a hotter topic than our own. Large-scale disconnect. Schoolwork, for the most part, has nothing to do with your life. If that's not the case, then why do students consult the internet only as a research source instead of some parts coming from their own observations? A perverted sense of satisfaction. With up-and-coming technologies and behaviors like instant gratification, what constitutes satisfying has drastically been altered. For example, we revere likes over conversations, fat, pathetic food, and short-term highs over a lifetime of health. Consequently, all this leads to misguided goals and pursuits such as social standing, fashion sense, and negative gossip, a direct result of our perverse mediums of satisfaction. The biological driving factor behind this is our brain's reward system, notably the release of our feel-good chemical dopamine, which has been evolutionarily tuned for a life of hard work, so it tends to fail us in the world of convenience and instant but momentary gratification. Here is Satan sitting next to a fourth grader in South Park. But if you look closely on the board Satan is holding, he's explaining the genetic predispositions and environmental factors that aid in developing an addiction to anything. The fact is that for us to evolve to a state where we no longer chase instant gratification would take millions of years and hundreds of thousands of generations at the least. Our body is pretty much the same as the first Homo sapiens who evolved around 200,000 years ago. This is why it's much more successful modifying our behaviors or reward systems to exploit biological tendencies than waiting for evolution to do the needful. Because let's face it, how many of us are actually capable of producing a germline that can self-sustain over thousands of generations? So what behaviors can we incorporate to live a life of greatness and meaning? People like Robin Sharma and Hal Elrod argue, and with good reason, about waking up early and having a foundational morning routine. This can include meditation, journaling, exercise, and planning your day. Speaking from experience, it works. 100% of this speech was written before 6:45 a.m., excluding the editing. Additionally, there are the environmental factors that I talked about. The people you spend time with, your habits, and what you choose to consume. As for this, the solution is straightforward, but the same can't be said about implementation. People are a big influence, whether it is those that are physically in our lives or ones we see on screens and try our best to emulate. Choose those people wisely. It is said that you're the average of the five people you spend most time with. This doesn't necessarily mean ditch your family and friends, but you could modify the conversations you have to make them more enriching and beneficial. As for our habits and the content we consume, they are very interlinked. Scheduling is a helpful tool. Depending on your needs, you can incorporate focus time, playing a sport, creative tasks, and reading, a personal favorite. Our habits are what we do. The content we consume are what the habits entail. So if your habit is playing tennis, then the content becomes exercise, movement, and learning about the game. But if your habit is spending 4+ hours on social media, then the content is degrading humor, perfect bodies and lifestyles, mindless scrolling, and targeted ads. Make and ingrain habits whose content is the direction you want your life going in. These are some resources that helped me embark on this journey, and I believe they will do the same for you. Deep Work by Cal Newport, The Miracle Morning by Hal Elrod, Man's Search for Meaning by Viktor E. Frankl, The 5 a.m. Club by Robin Sharma, and two documentaries by The Minimalists on Netflix. The shared significance of these changes is that they will help you live a fuller life with a much higher potential for professional and personal success. In the end, greatness is a quest which is not only worth pursuing, but should actively be sought, since the other path is regret. As strongly yet aptly said by Theodore Roosevelt, credit belongs to the man who actually strives to do the deeds, who knows great enthusiasms, the great devotions, who spends himself in a worthy cause, who at best knows the triumph of high achievement, and at the worst, if he fails, at least fails while daring greatly, so that his place shall never be with those cold and timid souls who neither knew victory nor defeat.
Wow, Watsal, that was truly inspiring.
Now we present to you Kripa Talwar, who will be talking about the characteristics of intellectualism and what makes a person smart. She will be touching upon these topics and how these are extremely subjective words and can't only be used to describe someone's academic brilliance. Take it away, Kripa.
Kids, I have a question. Do you all know what this is? A TV remote, right? Tata Sky for life. But where does this object disappear when our fathers are watching sports? When I was 8, my dad and I would have a weekly fight over who got to watch their show on the TV. Every Sunday was Barbie movie day for me, but I guess adults always find an excuse to get it their way. Likewise was the case with my father in watching cricket. This little fight has now turned into a weekly structured debate. We all know who Barbie is, an absolute sensation back when we were 5-year-olds. The Barbie dolls were manufactured by the American toy company Mattel in March of 1959 and has made profits in billions of dollars. So clearly it was and still is a huge success. Okay, enough of facts. I want to talk about some of the Barbie movies that I enjoy watching the most. Barbie the Princess and the Pop Star. This movie is next level. Barbie is a princess. Another Barbie lookalike, just with a different hair color, is a pop star. The princess has a magic hairbrush that changes hairstyles. The pop star has a magic mic that changes outfits. Both use their magic objects to look like each other and switch places because they're bored of their usual uneventful life. I mean, come on, if I was a princess, of course I'd want to trade places with a pop star and give up my royal life. It makes perfect sense. Okay, I'm going to stop right there. Weren't you all a little surprised that a 15-year-old who's gotten such a great opportunity to speak about almost anything in front of this huge audience is actually talking about pointless animated movies? But I'm not here to intellectualize the perpetual shift. But then again, what characterizes intellectualism? Now, literally speaking, the Oxford Dictionary has defined intelligence as the ability to acquire and apply knowledge and skills. Why is this definition incubated in our daily day-to-day life? Anybody who can obtain certain knowledge and is able to use it in their daily life is an intelligent person, right? Are there no shades of gray in life? Learning and practicing a moral from an animated movie, doesn't that make me intelligent too? I feel like these days, everywhere around us, the real meaning of smart is being misused. I mean, what does a typical family expect out of their child? Go to school, get better grades in Sapnantika Beta, get into a good college, and now you'll be successful at life. But that isn't true. Are there certain parameters which we need to constrain ourselves to? Each child has a different level of skill set. One might be phenomenal at studies, while the other is an amazing dancer, yet not so bright academically. The only difference is that one achieves higher marks on a piece of paper than the other one. You know, this can lead to serious stress and other mental health issues for the child, like anxiety and depression, because if they don't get the expected marks, they won't be considered smart, and they'll be compared to other kids by their own parents to a level that the children get highly motivated, demotivated. But now, let's talk about some of the famous, some famous, extremely successful personalities whose parameters fit in certain places and they outshined in them. First up, we have Al Gore. Albert Arnold Gore Jr. is an American politician and environmentalist who served as the 45th Vice President of the United States. He really never did well in college or school, usually coming in the bottom 20% of his class. He would usually also get low scores in natural sciences, which is ironic for someone who dedicates his time increasing awareness about climate change. Next is Walter Elias Disney. We all know about this great man and what company he started. I mean, these are classic movies we are talking about. But he was never really great at school. He dropped out at the age of 16 and joined the army. However, soon after, when he started working in the film industry, he faced a lot of failure until before becoming successful. We also have Cameron Diaz and Drew Barrymore, both exceptionally great actresses. However, just like the others on this list, they weren't very great at studies, and yet their school grades couldn't accurately guess their success at life. This list can go on and on for however long, because there are so many successful people who weren't considered intelligent in school. But the moral behind this is that regardless of the marks these people got when they were in school, they followed their dreams. When you truly follow your passion, you are obtaining knowledge and applying skills. And that is the literal definition of intelligence. When I was sitting inside a classroom with all these wonderful speakers from different grades, I panicked. I vividly remember the day. It was almost a year ago on Thursday. All of us students of the conference were supposed to meet to discuss our topics. I had zero clues about what I wanted to say. Nothing at all. Such great ideas from everyone who was sitting there that really got me thinking, Kripa, are you seriously so dumb? You don't know half of these words these people are using. What is wrong with you? I mean, all I wanted to do was talk about something which would impress all of you. So that when I left this conference, you'd remember me as a highly intellectual student of grade 10. But I didn't want your perceptions of judgment and intelligence to come in the way of my topic in order to avoid my categorization. I was lucky enough to be given this platform to express myself. But what if I just wanted to make conversation with you about the latest season of The Bachelor or fangirl over a boy band? Would that not be considered inspirability worthy? So then, in midst of my chaotic thoughts, my teacher came towards me and looked me straight into my eyes. She said, Kripa, are you okay? You look like you just killed someone. And then I ranted to her about my not so smart and not so thoughtful self. But here's what I realized after that conversation. Anything that you truly believe in and are passionate about is talent. You are acquiring knowledge and applying skills with even the slightest topic you take keen interest in. It is okay to be who you are and to like what you like. Anything and everything you believe in can be considered intelligent as long as you justify it correctly. And that is what I want to leave you with today. Thank you. That was truly brilliant, Kripa. Thank you so much.
Next up, we have Vidhi Channa, who will be enlightening us on Sigmund Freud's theory of dreams, which revolves around the human psyche. The stage is all yours, Vidhi.
How many of you have dreamt of something and then a while later it actually happened? Did anyone believe you when you told them? Probably not, right? Let me tell you something that happened when I was younger. I was in the third grade, and I had the strangest dream, which I still vividly remember till this day. I was sitting in the back towards the right corner of an unfamiliar classroom, seated across a large window with the sun shining brightly against the table opposite me, when a strange man with a red beard and circular glasses approached my table. He had green eyes, no hair, and he was very tall, considering the fact that I was in the third grade. A lot of you are about to be skeptical about what I'm about to say, but I swear this actually happened. 2 years later, when I had moved to another country and school, the exact same thing happened. The red-bearded bald man was my fifth grade teacher, and I had sat down in the exact same spot in the classroom with the sun shining in the exact same place that it was in my dream. Trust me, this isn't the Matrix, but you could say that I have 20/20 vision. Everything we experience is reflected in our dreams, our brains morphing known experiences to imaginative pieces, which could change the way we perceive certain topics. That experience made me theorize that life is perhaps even echoed in our dreams. So what I'm saying is, there have been theories in the past, and there will be theories in the future, because none of the theories can be disproved or proved. So researchers can keep trying to find different ways to find out meanings behind our dreams and why we have them, but it'll always be changing. Just like how civilization has changed, how each interpretation has expanded, how each theory finds a new way of thinking, it will constantly be changing. For example, when I was around the age of 5, I frequently dreamt about walking down Hollywood in a shiny gold sequin dress while wearing a lab coat, because at the time I was conflicted between my dreams of becoming an actress or a doctor. I know, childish dreams. Whereas now, I normally dream of morphed versions of school, colleges, and possibly impossible scenarios which involve ninjas and becoming a spy. But that's the thing. Dreams have been interpreted differently throughout the history of time. The Greeks thought that they predicted prophecies and legends. Aristotle concluded that dreams were due to residual movement in sensory organs. Freud thought they represented our innermost desires and were fulfillments of our childhood wishes. Carl Jung suggested that dreams are doing the work of integrating our conscious and unconscious lives. He called this the process of individuation. Now, I'm sure you've all heard the term unconscious, but did you know the importance of it in a neurological and psychological study? Freud theorized that there were 3 levels of the mind. He used the iceberg model to help people understand his theory and how what is unseen is the most important. On the surface is a consciousness which consists of these thoughts that are the focus of our attention, the now, the present. The preconscious consists of what all can be retrieved from our memory. The unconscious, which is right at the bottom of the iceberg, is hidden from all. The 3 levels had 3 different parts of the human psyche. The first was the ego, which is the preconscious. The ego is basically the median or the moderator between the superego and the id. How many of you have seen cartoons? You know when the character has to make a choice and an angel and a devil appear on their shoulders? Think of the id as the devil and the superego as the angel. A healthy psyche would have a balanced proportion between the id and superego, but the ego would ultimately make the decision. However, in a neurotic psych, the id or the superego could overpower the ego. Your superego, id, and ego all play a very powerful role in the way you dream and what your dreams could represent. Freud believed that there were two parts of a dream, manifest and latent. Manifest dreams are when your dreams have a literal meaning and don't have a deeper understanding. They could be your hopes or where you visualize yourself in the next 10 years. Latent dreams are the parts where there is a deeper meaning to your dream, which is where psychologists focus when they're treating patients. Freud believed that each dream represented what the primitive subconscious mind wanted or desired, or a possible fear we all have. For example, I'm sure we've all had dreams where we're falling. According to Freud, that would mean that one is contemplating into giving sexual urges, but there are many different interpretations for each dream, as it depends on an individual's past and traumas. Many philosophers and civilizations in the past have had contrasting views if compared to Freud. For example, the ancient Greeks had two categories for dreams, significant and insignificant dreams. Insignificant dreams were the ones which were a result of a bad day or sickness, but significant dreams were ones which involved gods, prophecies, and visions. I'm sure all of us here have experienced at least one incident where you went to sleep after having a bad day or being extremely stressed for something upcoming and had a dream about the exact scenario, but a morphed version of it. Think of one time you've had an important test or an event. The night before, you probably had an exaggerated or a morphed version of the event playing out in your head in your sleep. That's our subconscious telling us that the event or project is important to you and that you can't avoid it. A significant dream, according to the Greeks, would be one which involved foretelling of prophecies or oracles which can alter one's fate. Now, I'd like to leave you all with a question which I asked a couple of my friends. Do you think that our dreams are merely figments of our imagination, or do they have deeper meanings behind them? Thank you.
Thank you, Vidhi. I never knew my dreams had so much depth to them. Now we have Pavya Tatir. Pavya's speech will revolve around the trend to overthink and discuss how we pretend to know everything.
Over the course of 4 years, Shreya Suri has established a non-profit organization that helps to manage and celebrate menstrual hygiene across India. The taboo around menstruation is altering the development and empowerment of women around India. So today, she's here to discuss the inadequate education about menstrual hygiene and promote biodegradable sanitary napkins. Take it away, Shreya.
Greetings all. Did you know that only 18% of Indian women have access to proper sanitary essentials during their menstrual cycle? Yes, how surprised or perhaps aborted you might feel is exactly how I felt at the start of my journey. 4 years ago. 4 years ago, I visited my hometown near Punjab, and on my way back, I came across a slum area and began to ask women about their living conditions. I wanted to help them in whichever manner I could. Although they were slow to open up, but once they were well acquainted, I brought up the topic of menstrual hygiene. Their comfort dissipated, their shoulders rose, and looking around, and then they whispered, period in their colloquial lingo, something very similar to what I'm going to show you.
Can you explain what is this? Why are you not answering?
वही तो भगवान ने पता।
यहाँ
जाके
इसको पता है पीरियड्स क्या होते हैं? नाम सुने?
ये तो जी
घंटे वाले पीरियड्स जो मतलब बोलजी में चलते हैं।
नहीं।
पैर घंटे पैर समझते हैं
ना? नाम भी नहीं सुना नाम भी तुम्हारा नहीं सुना।
पता ही नहीं कैसे
करेंगे?
कपड़ा सा भी यूज करते हैं।
ज़्यादातर मैंने ये देखा है कि मतलब इतनी छूट नहीं है लड़कियों के लिए जॉब कर सकें या फिर कुछ कर सकें इंडिपेंडेंट हो सके
एक मशीन लग रही है काठीखेरा में सुना है आपने इसके बारे में
Sigh.
stolen pillowcases, bedsheets, toilet paper, and cloth rags found on the streets. These were the items that women from those slums used most commonly during that time of the month. I spoke to women from the age of 14 to the age of 54. The experience may have increased, but the hesitation remained the same. When I left home from the slum later that day, I had to reflect on how privileged I was and how I had the means to bring about change, but had done nothing substantial up until that point. I had to make positive change for what I had the power and drive, support of my family, and the perspective of my educational opportunities. I then began talking to different nonprofit organizations. For an adolescent, volunteering seemed the most convenient option, right? However, I soon found out that none of the nonprofit organizations within my contact and reach openly and sustainably supported menstrual hygiene. Not to point fingers, but the most common reasons were either due to lack of funds or lack of displayed need. I then realized that this would require a bigger initiative. Came last year of primary school, amidst the PYP exhibition panels and graduation ceremony practices, I found an organization and initiated a collaboration that stemmed from my interactions from the slums, the seventh period and Nora. The seventh period is a national nonprofit organization run by the youth that strives to manage and celebrate menstrual hygiene through education, service, and national distribution of hygiene products. On the other hand, Nora is a startup that works to produce affordable biodegradable pads. Combining both these initiatives with the assistance from Nora, the seventh period's network of more than 300 volunteers across India have distributed over 2,500 care packages to more than 83 slum areas in India within 9 states. And today we continue to expand our network. Working with Nora and the seventh period has made me think about women empowerment for quite some time now. And I would like to share my thoughts with you all. Women empowerment has been on the forefront, but along with that, we must consider the taboo of menstruation in countries like India and think about how it hampers with women empowerment. According to FEM International, periods are the number one reasons that girls miss school in developing countries. When we're working towards providing more opportunities and quality education, why not consider what is stopping them from pursuing those opportunities in the first place? Speaking of quality education, did you know that in India, out of every 10 girls, 3 are not aware of menstruation at the time of their first period? Yes. And 83% of women use unhygienic ways to manage their blood flow. Therefore, I firmly believe that when we talk about quality education about menstrual hygiene must also be incorporated. I have previously talked about my experience interacting with women in slum areas about periods. Now let me take you through the reaction I received from men. The word period was most often met with overwhelming laughter or extreme anger. This made me realize it is important as it is for women to be aware about menstruation and hygiene. It is equally important for the concept to be normalized in all parts of our nation, for both men and women. It is an appeal to the mothers, the teachers, the sisters, the aunts, the grandmothers, and to all the women out there. Work to normalize the concept of periods for boys and girls from a younger age. A girl's first period can be scary, as it signals a transition in one's body and life. And at this point, she needs support from all those around, which she will only receive if the issue is not treated as a taboo. Similarly, my organization, the Seventh Period, also works to explain to both men and women how natural periods are, as it is an evolutionary essential component of our life. People may come to certain senses of the discomfort to the seventh period, but I like to believe that they leave transformed. They leave evolved as a part of their menstrual movement, men and women alike. Aisha Suri, the founder of the seventh period, and Nora, which is an organization that enables women to exist in their conventional zones and instead be self-sufficient to be able to ignite the flame of life, stand as strong advocates for women to be able to define their own meaning of life and not let others define what life means to them. To all those seated here in the audience today, join me on my journey to normalize periods and provide gratification to women across the nation. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Shreya, for that inspirational talk. This is definitely a cause that we, as a society, need to spread more awareness and talk about. Have you ever gotten so lost in a story where you feel as if you connect so deeply with the characters and their world starts to feel like your own? Well, our final speaker for Inspireability today will be exploring the human character relations that form and how they can mirror reality while outlining the perpetual shift in the way we form emotional identities and connections.
Let's talk about stories. Beloved characters, the devastating ending of Endgame. It really did hurt, and I definitely felt a sharp pain spike through my chest, fill my words with vengeance as I held a grudge over men and women in garishly colored suits. So today I'm here to discuss the perpetual shift in the way we form emotional identities and connections. Now, as a community, we have seen ourselves grow to become more complicated in most areas of our life. And oftentimes we map and acknowledge these changes as a redefinition of a concept. Take, for example, how we discuss scientific development, political development, or social development, and how, when each of these are discussed today, we've accepted what they mean to us now as the definition, what they meant to us before as a pointer map change, and the transition between these two points as evidence of our evolution. Now, ever since I was a child, I have formed deep emotional connections with people. People without regard to them being an element of my physical reality. Fiction, put simply. But to me, it wasn't fictional. It was very real, and I experienced emotions as deep and substantial as those I formed in reality. Ranging from my early friendship with the brilliant Matilda when I was 6, to the multitudes of Theodore Decker, who I encountered about 2 years ago, to feeling great affection for Spider-Man, who I've followed on screen since I was very young. Point is, I have lived multiple lives. I've been on the other side of multiple emotional connections. And as our world has developed, so has the way we define the criteria for emotional connections. And this development isn't born and built all in itself. No, changes in other parts of our lives have realized this change as well. Our deepening understanding of human emotion and its underlying patterns has brought considerable change to how filmmakers, writers, advertisers, and politicians put their messages across with increased efficacy. But this understanding would mean nothing without the ability to portray it effectively. So how exactly do we do that? Development in our grasp over visual and auditory media allows us today to move an audience without having said very much. Through the visual arts or cinematography and the resource of technology, giving it a pillar to stand on. But there is often much more behind the formation of these emotional connections. And a lot of it has to do with personal projection and the manipulation of emotional patterns across people. We form strong connections with situations unknown to us purely based on our shared humanity. A humanity which allows us to pick up on the subtleties of a scene without having experienced its context. Motion introduces these intricacies, which stand alone and are universal to all human interpretation. The context of the plot often being the only thing alien in this sea of art. scene from the movie Roma, directed by Alfonso Cuarón, introduced without context, manages to connect with an audience because of these shared nuances of identity. To feel for a character without having ever met them. A broken community, which may not be your own, is depicted with enough art to make you think about the day your personal life was in turmoil, providing a window not only into an unknown situation, but also into yourself. Now, the movement of the camera in the chaos scene evokes similar emotion in each viewer, but the connections made with the characters in the scene are often dependent on the viewer's own personal identity and relationships. We view a character for more than just themselves, but also projections of ourselves in situations we see them in. This often brings us closer than ever to an alien person or concept on a screen or on a page. It makes one wonder, is the reality of a person even necessary to form emotional relationships and connections? Does one even need face-to-face interaction when interaction based on personal projection and observation on a fictional character provides as much emotional involvement? This is why my heart broke when I watched Peter Parker turn to dust and just drift away with the wind painfully slow, because I found myself drawing connections between him and people in my reality who I associated him with. Now, in all this, the chaotic emotional identities existing simultaneously with sedate identities within me, I have found myself to have lived a colorful life from within four walls, without necessarily interacting with someone in flesh and blood. Nonetheless, the connections I formed have taught me all that I know about people and emotional concepts, human connections and existential connections. It is important we acknowledge what emotional involvement means today. Acknowledge that it can be attained through virtual interaction, through reading, watching movies, listening to podcasts, or the radio, or music, anything and everything. Because by acknowledging this, we are not undermining our emotion, nor are we propagating ignorance, but we are simply mapping our change and celebrating our evolution in all spheres of life. Now, I would like to leave you all with a scene from the movie Sleepless in Seattle, something which warmed my heart, as did hers in the clip, just by listening to someone on the radio. I hope I engaged your thoughts today. Thank you.
Marcia, or should I call you Dr. Fieldstone?
Dr. Marcia.
Dr. Marcia. I don't mean to be rude.
Oh, and I don't want to invade your privacy. Oh,
sure you do.
Go on, Sam. I'm listening. Sam?
We had a pretty tough time there at first.
Mm-hmm.
But we're dealing with it. And Jonah and I will get along just fine again as soon as I break his radio.
I have no doubt that you're a wonderful father. You know, you can tell a lot from a person's voice.
You certainly can.
But something must be missing if Jonah still feels that you're under a cloud. And just a few questions. Are you sleeping at night?
He doesn't sleep at all.
How do you know that?
I live here, Dad.
Look, it's Christmas. Maggie, my wife, she really did it. She loved it. She made everything beautiful. And it's just tough this time of year. I mean, any kid needs a mother.
Could it be that you need someone just as much as Jonah does?
Yes.
Don't answer that. Let's get into that right after these messages.
Thank you so much, Anushka. That was truly engaging. With this, we come to the end of the conference. We would like to thank our school director, Ms. Mehta, for encouraging us to hold Inspireability and guiding us throughout. We would also like to thank our middle school principal, Ms. Monica Bajaj, for her constant support and help. we thank Ms. Abhilasha Yadav for leading this event and making it happen. Thank you so much for joining today. Hope you all enjoyed and learned something. Stay safe and keep learning. Thank you.